Let's go to Washington, D.C., where Zack Ford is standing by. He's the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. Everybody should read him over at Think Progress. What is your Twitter handle, sir?
Zack Ford, ZackFord.
And if people want to reach out to you, they should, because you're a teacher.
They should.
You're a teacher.
Say hi, tell me what you think. I had a student at a university in Texas reach out a couple weeks ago and just ask me a general question about sanctuary cities, which I think I'd written about maybe one time. And, you know, I went out of my way to say, here's why I feel sanctuary cities are important. Here's, you know, some information you might not have about immigration or some misinformation that you might need to correct. And I never heard back from him, but I, you know, tried to give him a thoughtful response.
Great. Great. You know, we had Noam Chomsky on the Ralph Nader Radio Hour last week, third time he's been on. He's very available, Noam Chomsky, as is Ralph. The great minds don't hide. They are available. Just something to think about. Reach out and ask Zack questions. You even go to people's schools, don't you?
I would be happy to. Yeah. I don't get to as much as I'd like.
Right. Okay, I have a bone to pick with the universe, and then we'll start.
Go for it.
Okay. I'm not going to violate anybody's privacies. Privacies? But one of the questions I ask of really accomplished people is, what is your reading diet? How do you get through the day? I will lie on my back with my Kindle, with my iPad, 12 hours straight, Zack Ford, reading. Just nonstop. I put down the Kindle, and then I'll go down and do John Fugelsang's show over at Sirius XM, and I don't know anything. Zero. How is that possible to spend 12 hours going through all these magazines and newspapers and not know anything?
You know, I've definitely had stories that I'd forgotten that I had written, and I'm working on another story, and I was like, this issue sounds familiar. I wonder why that, you know, I wonder where I heard about this before. And I look it up and I'm like, oh, right, because I wrote about it before.
But how do you keep up? Now, I asked a couple of people recently, what do they read? What do they read? And people should read Zack over at Think Progress. And they should read Think Progress because it does a good job of keeping it short and getting to the point. But I'm surprised. A lot of people I truly respect who are very critical of the New York Times can't get through the day without devouring the New York Times over everything else. What is your baseline? What do you have to read every day? Ralph Nader, for example, and I'm not violating a trust here, he said to me, if you want to establish a intellectual baseline every day, you read the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, and the Washington Post, cover to cover, and that just sets you on your way, and it prepares you for other things to read.
Well, I would say I'm probably more of a millennial in that it's very rare that I read a newspaper cover to cover, and while I'm certainly, you know, seen a lot of articles on any given day from major newspapers, I am not personally going to their sites to seek them out. That's just not ever been my personal preference in terms of news reading. For me, it's a little old-fashioned, I think, but I still have a ton of RSS feeds set up that I have organized into some different categories, but there are a number of sort of aggregators that I trust who are sort of catching articles that I might want to look at. Or just picking up stories themselves that I want to read. And so for me, it's an oversaturation of a whole lot of different outlets that I have already sort of manicured for myself so that it's very perfectly organized the way that I want it and doesn't lead me down too many rabbit holes of content that I don't want to look at. So, you know, I'm sorting through hundreds of articles through my RSS feed reader every day. I also have a bajillion Google alerts. I've used those less and less because they are, you know, a bigger burden to go through. But for all of the different kind of issue areas that I cover, they can be an effective way of just finding stories that you might not realize are out there or, you know, information from even other countries that might not be picked up by U.S. outlets. So it's a lot. And you know what I tell people is I rarely am interested in sitting down and reading a book because I'm spending so much time every day scouring all of these articles that by the end of the day, I'm looking for any other kind of medium in which to process new information other than reading. So I'm not ashamed of my binge watching habits or my video game playing.
Okay, did you go to college?
I did, in fact, go to college.
What'd you major in?
Grad school, even.
Yeah, let's go through this, because I'm going to make a larger point here.
I have a bachelor's in music education, and I have a master's degree in student affairs and higher education.
So you got a master's, and did you aggregate information, or did you depend on a specific institution that you trusted to tell you what to learn?
A little bit of both, I would say. You know, some of the professors that I respected the most had a lot of different sources of reading and research in our classes.
But so, you picked a specific university, and you stuck
with... There's not really a good alternative to that, fortunately.
Well, hang on. But there's a reason we do this, and this is my speaking up for the New York Times, Think Progress, The Economist, The Nation. So you picked a specific university. You chose one that you said, this one I want to put it all down on, right?
Sure.
Okay. They aggregated all the information you needed to get your master's.
That is true.
Do you think there's a problem when the student kind of picks his major and picks what he's going to learn and then self-grades? Don't you need somebody aggregating the information and saying to you, look, we have 1,000 people in this newsroom scouring the events, this is what's important. This is what we think is important. Don't we need
I hope that's the job of journalists. It's not only to find the information and present it in a way that is accessible for people to understand, but also to make judgment calls about what is important and judgment calls about what context is important for those various stories. And I think that's why I'm really proud to work at a publication like Think Progress that owns our commitment to a progressive point of view and how we believe that will best support people across the society, and don't pretend that positions that could hurt a lot of people have equal merit if they don't actually have equal merit.
Okay. I guess I'm taking a Marie Kondo approach to reading the news, but
if you're waiting for news that sparks joy, not look at news at all.
I was just going to say that. There is, however, a necessity to not only read stories that bring you joy. And I think we get into trouble when we do that, because there's some stories you just have to read. Here's the problem that I think millennials are up against. And you are a millennial, right?
I am.
Okay. My father taught me how to read the New York Times. That's when it was just paper. He said, you read the entire front page. It says continued on page 37. Don't go there. Just read the entire front page first. You might be tempted to go immediately to the continued page, but don't do it. Then go to the back. Read the editorials. Then read the op-ed page. And then when you're done reading the front page, the editorials, and the op-ed, which is opposite of the editorials on the other side of the paper, then you can start skimming the paper. But that's your baseline. That was my father's teaching. And that is what he was taught. That was like a New York thing to do. Well, you don't have paper anymore.
What is the paper thing that you speak of?
I know. I taught my kids that you have to pick a newspaper like the New York Times or the Washington Post or the LA Times, one newspaper, and you read the first paragraph of every story. You don't have to do that all at once, but by the end of the day, if you've read the first paragraph of every story in one single newspaper, you have a general idea of what's going on. I don't know how people can take on 20,000 RSS feeds without sinking.
It's a challenge, but it's also a commitment, right? You know, it's not that I'm doing it for pleasure. It's because I have a job, and finding what other people are talking about and how they're talking about it is part of that job. So, you know, I can justify it that the time I'm taking to read articles is something that I'm getting paid to do, not necessarily what everyone's experience is. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you have to decide what information you need, what are the best ways to get it, how much time are you committed to collecting that information, and where, what are the most trustworthy places to get that information efficiently. And, you know, that, like I said, that's why I write for a place like Think Progress. But, you know, I think your example of, you know, read the first paragraph of anything or of everything speaks to, you know, like kind of what Twitter in some ideal world could have been. You know, I also look at Twitter and other social media to find information and how people are talking about it. And you kind of see some summarizations there that, you know, spare you from going to read every full article. But
you're right. You're absolutely
also just
right.
A terrible place in general. So
Twitter is a terrible place. I have been going down that rabbit hole. And it is interesting. If you have reliable sources on Twitter, it can be magnificent. Part of the Trump administration is applying the shock doctrine to America. Keep throwing something new at us every day. Keep us confused. And while that's going on, they're selling off our land. So I think we have to be careful on what we focus on. And the story I always tell, and then we'll move on to your stories. The story I always tell is I did an experiment. I was working on Real Time with Bill Maher, where our job was to be the smartest people Bill Maher knew. It's one of the greatest jobs I ever had. It's just you sat. It was like the opening scene from 3 Days of the Condor, the Robert Redford Faye Dunaway movie. They just had reading rooms over at the CIA. You know, you work over at Real Time with Bill Maher. Your job is to spend half your workday just reading.
Right.
And this was overwhelming. And we did an experiment. A friend of mine and I, we were working there. I said, you know what? I'm just going to read the New York Times from cover to cover. That's it. I'm not going to go to every website. I'm just going to read the New York Times for a month. And I'm going to see how informed I am vis-a-vis the rest of the writers. You know, except for some pop culture things. I found that I was able to keep up with everybody by devouring just the New York Times. Just the New York, and going to their links. If they hyperlinked, I would go to their hyperlinks. But getting all my information from the New York Times, it's a pretty good aggregator. I just don't want people to feel confused and overwhelmed, because they are right now by everything, and they're not focusing on what's important. For example, Congresswoman Ilhan Omar. I am finding this to be an example of people throwing dirt in our eyes, especially the eyes of the Democratic Party. This is, I think, one of the most nonsensical debates. It takes our eye off the ball. I really don't want to talk about it other than this is the least of America's concerns right now. You wrote a whole piece about this. There's a problem in Gaza. There's a problem in Israel. If you are a Muslim serving in Congress, you have a responsibility to speak up for the Muslims and the Palestinians. Otherwise, there's no debate. There's no point in having a democracy if Congresswoman Omar can't talk and criticize Israel. As far as the Democrats are concerned, yes, this is a issue that has to be discussed. But the House is on fire right now. There's a guy in the Oval Office who is purposely dividing the Arabs, the Muslims, the Jews, the blacks, the Hispanics, the gays, the straights. That's their plan. And when the Democratic Party starts arguing over Israel, they're not putting out the big fire.
I totally agree, and the story infuriates me to no end. You know, I don't want to say that every single comment that Omar has made is totally unimpeachable, but I think what's important is that she is making valid critiques, and where she's misstepping with the words that she chooses, she is apologizing in thoughtful ways and working with Jewish groups to do better and to continue to build those bridges, where it makes sense to. And so this whole idea that she is the villain, that she is the, you know, symbol of hate in the country is just absolutely absurd. And what I tried to show in my piece was that, you know, this weekend, Representative Jim Jordan, who many people might remember from covering up a sexual abuse scandal when he was a wrestling coach at Ohio State University, and might also recognize for his very just fiery display at the Michael Cohen hearing last week that Bill Hader reenacted on Saturday
yes,
Night Live.
Yes, yeah, the form-fitting shirts.
Indeed, indeed. He, you know, he attacked progressive mega donor Tom Steyer on Twitter and used a dollar sign in Steyer's name. Now, technically, Steyer is Episcopalian, but his father's Jewish. He has a Jewish name, and several other big progressive donors are also Jewish. And I'm not sure that Jim Jordan knows the difference. And so it was pretty clear that this was, you know, a little anti-Semitic.
Jerry Nadler went after him for that. And to me, the dollar sign is not the Star of David. I have to disagree with you on that.
Kevin McCarthy had done the exact same thing back in the fall, but also named two other Jewish donors. And so I think these Republicans' heads, all of these big donors are the same thing, and they symbolize this, you know, archaic trope of Jewish people being obsessed with money or having lots of money and trying to, you know.
It's the boy who cried Wolfowitz. If you keep screaming anti-Semitism on dollar signs, after a while, people just, they flatline on it. They go, I can't, you know.
I think there's totally some legitimacy to that, David. But, of course, that was the first thing that people cried at Omar about, right? So it's about the double standard, right? Mm-hmm. Here is a Muslim woman who is in Congress and speaking out and speaking very thoughtfully about a lot of things, as are some of her other new members of Congress who are also women of color. And, you know, they're just constantly bombarded by it. And you see a lot of people attacking Omar, who themselves have documented, you know, tweets or statements that are themselves racist or anti-Semitic in other ways. And so they just want to look like, oh, well, we're the white guys and we're calling out the woman of color for being a bad guy. But that's, they're not actually trying to enforce any standard of decency whatsoever, mm-hmm. right? They're just trying to win. They're just trying to look like they have the upper hand. And it's pretty despicable. And I think you're totally right that it's become a real distraction from, you know, the kinds of issues that the House should be debating. And it annoys me to no end that many Democrats are falling for it and feel the need to fall for it, because in some cases, they're only confirming the legitimacy of the critiques that she's actually making.
Right. Right. And it's evil because when you take people who are scared, and we have Arabs and Jews who are scared in this country, let's look at the Latino, the Hispanic population here in America. Donald Trump doesn't care about the influx of undocumented workers. There's a story out about Eric and Donald. They have a hunting retreat in upstate New York that's run by an undocumented worker. They have five golf courses under the Trump banner that have hired undocumented workers. They don't care about undocumented workers. They have found a political opening, a weakness that they perceive in the Democratic Party. So he says, let's build a wall, because it's political expediency. He doesn't mean it. It's just show everybody, though, takes it seriously, or not everybody, but enough people take it seriously that Hispanics and Latinos, their lives get destroyed, not just trying to get into this country, but the ones who live here. We have internment camps now here in America, so he can score political points. This Arab-Jew thing and the fighting among ourselves, at first it starts off as, hey, we don't really mean it, really. It's just political expediency. Next thing you know, they're shooting up mosques and synagogues. You're lighting a fire that you can't put out. It's really irresponsible to get caught up in it if you're a Jew or an Arab. You really have to tamp it down. It doesn't have to be addressed at this level. When you address it at this level, you're fanning the flames, and it can get really dangerous.
I totally agree. And I think the other thing, though, is that, you know, the same people who are attacking Omar and ignoring Jim Jordan and Kevin McCarthy and others are fomenting a lot of hate themselves. And so this is all about deflection. It's all about saying, oh, you can't hold me responsible for any of the hate because, look, I'm calling out this person's hate, even though it is politically expedient for me to do so and not in other cases.
Yeah. Ileana Omar is straddling the line between anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism. And I guess she got into trouble for saying it's all about the Benjamins.
Right. That was one of the first comments that she made.
What she should have said is it's all about the Benjamin Netanyahu's. Then it's not anti-Semitic. Then it's anti-Zionism.
The problem is that there are all these conflations that happen, right? That you can't respect Jewish people without respecting whatever the state of Israel is doing, because the existence of the state of Israel is indistinguishable from whatever the government of Israel is doing. And there's also people who are religiously Jewish and people who are ethnically Jewish. And if you talk about one, you're talking about the other. And so there are all of these conflations that happen that prevent real dialogue from happening about, you know, can you oppose the Netanyahu administration and still support Israel? And what does that mean? And how can you articulate that? And can you, you know, support the existence of Israel and oppose the occupation? And what does that mean? And how does that look like?
Mm-hmm.
How do you talk about that? How does that play out? And I think that that's really what Omar is trying to call out, and she might not always be doing it in the best possible way, but she's continuing to learn, and she's continuing to persevere, and she's continuing to, you know, maintain relationships as opposed to, you know, actually being anti-Semitic. And everyone else is sort of trying to hold on to all of these other conflations. And I think that's the biggest problem is we don't have a way to have nuanced conversation about these issues. And we haven't for a long time. And I, for one, am glad to see Omar kind of starting to chip away at that a little bit and trying to force us to reconcile that, you know, there's a real civil rights issue in the occupations. And there is a real concern about the existence of Israel too, but what does that mean? And do we only support that because evangelical Christians have realized that they need to enforce that? And there's a whole, you know, separate set of dogmas that might be informing that position. There's just so much to unpack there. And, you know, it'll be challenging, but I'm really glad that we're actually kind of starting to unpack that.
Yeah, and most Americans, and rightfully so, because they're not being fed the right diet of news, all they're told is there's a skirmish within the Democratic Party over Israel. God forbid MSNBC takes a break from promoting their neoliberal Russiagate investigation and send one of their reporters to Israel and, you know, once a week explain. God forbid Rachel Maddow explain what's going on in Israel, what both sides are saying, a little history lesson. They don't do that. They'll just report that there's a civil war within the Democratic Party between the millennials, the women, and the old guard. Can't have the right discussion about this. We should get the information in America that the Israelis get. In other words, we just get the Bibi Netanyahu, who, by the way, may be going to prison.
Right, he was just indicted this week.
Yeah, they may lock up Bibi Netanyahu. AIPAC has a little too much influence and power, and there are other Jewish lobbyists, there's J Street. It's not the most important problem facing this country right now.
I think the important distinction is that hate is an issue that's really facing our country right now, but Representative Omar is not the source of it,
yeah.
Right? She is not the source.
She's the victim of it.
And very much so, we don't see all of the condemnations of Islamophobia. We don't see all of the responses to how people talk to and about her. We just see her as an example to prop up this other idea.
What is the record when it comes to LGBTQ persecution in the Arab world? Somebody sent me a piece from a rabid Zionist who wants to go after Omar. This is what I've heard for decades. If the liberals are so concerned about the LGBTQ community and women, they should take a look at how the Arab community treats gays and women. Is that true?
No, I mean, this is pure whataboutism. And,
Yeah.
I think we talked about this a little bit a few weeks ago when the story came out about the plan Trump doesn't know about to decriminalize homosexuality abroad, because it's something that comes up a lot among gay Republicans, actually, who are, trying to defend so much of this conservative rhetoric and are very much themselves motivated by Islamophobia, and so look for every opportunity to sort of pin it all on, why are you harassing Christian bakers? Christian bakers aren't the ones hanging you for being gay. So, we should be focusing more on, hating Iran. But when you look at polling in the United States, Muslim Americans are far more likely to support gay rights than white evangelicals. So
Really?
it's this,
Wow.
crazy assumption that's based on stereotype that completely ignores the fact that there are LGBTQ Muslims, just like there are LGBTQ Catholics and LGBTQ evangelicals and LGBTQ Mormons. They're there, and their communities are often very supportive. So it's this conflation of, Sharia law, the scary thing, and the specters of quote unquote radical Islamic terrorism that paint this picture of particularly conservative values, but completely ignores the reality that people are living.
When I said the Arab world, I meant like the Middle East. How are women and the LGBTQ community treated over there? Because I keep hearing that liberals and progressives and lefties should be highly critical of the Arab world when it comes to their treatment of women and the LGBTQ community. I'm not talking about here in the United States.
Certainly, if you look at countries like Saudi Arabia or Qatar or Iran, there are certainly very, strict laws that govern the behavior of women and LGBTQ people. And I'm not disputing that, but we have to just be really careful about drawing the distinction between these regimes and the laws that are in place there versus who's actually there and what are their experiences and in their own communities, how do they live, and how does that translate to what Muslim people around the rest of the country, how they're living their lives and what their values are. And so I hear what you're saying, that you're specifically asking about those countries, and I'm not really disputing those countries, but I think it's really important to just maintain that they don't represent Islam, right? They represent the most conservative version of Islam, and unfortunately, countries that are run according to it. But that's not what everyone who is Muslim believes.
Yeah.
Two different things can be both bad to different degrees, and you can
Right.
object to both at the same time. And particularly if there's someone that you believe is on your side, or that you believe shares more of your values, or is more closely politically aligned with you, it's easier to hold them accountable. And so I think that that's what a lot of people are afraid to admit and afraid to acknowledge, that, when we're talking about our allies, when we're talking about democracies, when we're talking about, countries that supposedly share some of the same freedoms that our country was built on, and we look to them and say, you need to sort of like act more the part, and not be involved in the suppression. It's important to do that, not because, they're a more important target, but because that's where change can happen, and should be happening more quickly. It's much harder to say, hey, your entire regime, and the conservative religious values that it's based on needs to be completely deconstructed. You can't make as much progress there. So you have to sort of recognize we can do both at the same time, try to advocate for change in these strict regimes, but also, hold our friends accountable.
Yeah. I want to talk about Stephon Clark. He was a 22-year-old African American who was shot, some say in the back, by Sacramento police. And Xavier Becerra, the Attorney General of California, said he will not be pursuing the police in this case. And I watched a demonstration that took place within a city council meeting in Sacramento after this decision was made. They're not going to prosecute the two officers. And there was a young African American who stood up on one of the desks at the city council meeting and started screaming. And then other people joined him, and he wasn't arrested. It was a very powerful protest.
We sometimes forget why the Black Lives Matter movement is called Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
And it's because they're countering the experience of feeling like their lives don't matter, that the number of times that unarmed black men are shot to death by police and there is no accountability for the police is still innumerable.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was writing about how these charges weren't going to be pursued on Sunday when I was helping, you know, cover Think Progress's weekend shift. And it happened to be the anniversary of the day of the Rodney King beating.
Hmm.
And, you know, that was almost three decades ago at this point. And, you know, we had the massive Los Angeles riots to, you know, call out this police brutality, which were very deadly and violent. And almost three decades later, we're still talking about the same issue and nothing's changed.
Well,
so I think that's the importance of the Black Lives Matter movement, is saying we still need that reminder that Black Lives Matter, because our society is still not acting like it.
People explained the cop behavior away, and they did it with Stephon Clark. They thought, well, he has an arrest record. He's been in and out of jail. And the cops made an honest mistake. They mistook a white cell phone for a gun.
It's amazing to me the way that we're able to sort of explain these things away. And what it always comes down to for me is that it's not really about the cop's behavior. It's about devaluing the life of the person who was shot. It's saying that they didn't deserve, you know, the proper jurisprudence of, you know, how to be tried for whatever they did or did not do wrong, assuming they did something wrong, which isn't even always the case. But just sort of trying to justify their death, right? Not just justify the cop's actions, but justify their death and be okay with it. And it just breaks my heart every time I read one of these stories, because, you know, we see the same thing with stories from the border, and these people who are fleeing all kinds of persecution, you know, whether it's gang related or anti-LGBTQ in Central America, and trying to just find a place where they can live safely. And people are just so content to, you know, either put babies in cages or just turn them away and send them back to whatever violence is waiting for them there. It's as if their lives don't matter as much or don't have the same human value. And I think we have to just keep calling that out and encouraging each other to say, you know, they might not have been born in the same circumstances. They might not have had the same opportunities. They might have had to make difficult choices that got them in trouble with the law, but they're still people.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to value their lives and recognize their rights under the law in the same way as everybody else.
Talk to me about Oklahoma, what happened there, and what was Assembly Bill 392 in California?
So Assembly Bill 392 would limit the justifications for using deadly force. It's an attempt to sort of push back on this idea that as long as the cops feel like they're threatened, they can use deadly force. So it's still a pending bill, but I think it's the right start to sort of say, you know, we can't just have this free open pass for police without any consequences for, you know, making, you know, these really poor or rash decisions. In Oklahoma, we had another situation. This was another black man who was unarmed, who was shot to death by an officer. It occurred back in 2016. And the officer had already been acquitted of manslaughter charges. She was actually charged, but was acquitted in her case. She's since resigned her position, but the federal government was investigating whether there were civil rights charges that should be investigated there. And they concluded that there were not. So here's a situation where, you know, we had this sort of backup mechanism that could have, you know, afforded some accountability for this needless death. And it still didn't get us anywhere.
Mm. Every time a cop pulls over an African American, because many of these cops are racist, they automatically assume that the African American has an automatic. Well, why don't we get rid of the guns?
I totally agree. I mean, if we didn't have guns everywhere, we wouldn't assume that everybody might have a gun.
Yeah.
And we've seen other nations do drastic things to take back guns from the public and really reduce gun ownership, and it's made a big difference. I think Australia is one of the best examples because there were a lot of guns out there that they had to bring in, but people actually followed through,
yeah.
and it became a safer country as a result. You notice that some of the same people who advocate for guns are the same white men who, you know, are advocating for all of the other things that might keep people of color or people of lower socioeconomic status in their negative circumstances. So it's not a coincidence.
The problem is good guys with a gun, the cops. Talk to me about, before you go, Nebraska's LGBTQ employment protections bill. I'm always amazed when we bring this up. It is legal in some states to fire somebody.
Most states.
I'm sorry?
Most states. It's legal in most states to fire somebody for being gay.
You can actually call somebody into your... I'm laughing because it's just so amazing. You can call somebody into your office and say, I'm firing you because you're gay.
Yep.
And you write down reasons for termination. Gay.
Homosexuality.
Somebody should do that. Somebody should do that just to test it in the courts.
The problem is that it has been tested in the courts. And, increasingly, we've talked about this before, courts are recognizing sexual orientation protections under the sex protections that we already have. That, you know, you can't discriminate on the basis of sexual orientation without making some consideration about either the sex of the person that they might be having romantic relations with or stereotypes related to their sexuality. But, state by state, it's still inconsistent.
Yeah. What if somebody at the Advocate fired somebody for being straight?
I mean, the law doesn't say for being gay. It says based on sexual orientation. So, you know, they would have just as valid a case, you know. And actually, a lot of the protections that we now recognize happened because of things happening in the court that we didn't anticipate. And so, you know, one of the big cases that helped us recognize sex stereotyping as a protected act, or are protected from discrimination based on sex stereotyping, was a case where a man was experiencing sexual harassment. And it was even Justice Scalia, who most people think of as pretty conservative, who in that opinion said, you know, the law might not have been written to anticipate that it would be a man who was a victim of sexual harassment, but that doesn't mean that that's not protected under the, you know, the law doesn't apply to him.
Yeah.
And so it could go the other way. But in Nebraska, you know, when we talk about non-discrimination protections, this is going to come up next week because Congress is going to introduce the Equality Act, which would create federal protections based on employment and housing, public accommodations like businesses and storefronts, education, and even in credit. We talk about all of those things as being important to cover under the law. And Nebraska was only trying to do employment. They weren't even trying to do housing or public accommodation.
Wow.
Just employment. And, you know, a lot of the lawmakers were talking about the brain drain. You know, people don't feel like they can live comfortably in this state based on their sexual orientation. People had personally heard stories of people being denied jobs or losing jobs just because they were gay. And yet there were still lawmakers who said, well, we think people are actually coming back to Nebraska. We think young people like how conservative it is here. It's just,
wow.
Well, maybe, but they're not the queer ones. And so they killed the bill.
And any boycotts of what comes out of Nebraska? Besides
corn.
Well, that would be good for everybody to boycott corn.
It would be both healthy
yeah.
and politically viable, perhaps.
Yeah. Former military secretaries asserting that the Pentagon misled Congress on trans troops. Before you go, just give us an update on that, please.
Sure. So, you know, we had this fiery testimony last week. Well, I don't know if it was fiery, but I was fired up about it, where Pentagon officials basically said that, you know, the reason a transgender person cannot enlist in the military, even after they've taken all of the steps to transition, is that it's similar to having a disease, like heart disease or cancer. And so we've just seen a really big pushback from a lot of folks. The story you're referencing was about three former secretaries, someone who once one from the Army, one from the Air Force, and one from the Navy. Previously the top civilian officials in those organizations, calling out this misleading information. But there was also a report from a whole bunch of professors at the different military academies who also called out all the junk science that was relied on. And there was another letter from a group of a couple dozen retired generals and admirals who also said, look, whatever you're trying to do to defend this ban, you are not actually representing good military judgment, and you are not making a decision that actually benefits readiness or cohesion. And, you know, it remains to be seen how the ban will play out in courts or whether Congress will, you know, try to reverse Trump's efforts. But there's just a very strong pushback to the nonsense that we heard to Congress last week.
Okay. Unfortunately, to be continued. Zack Ford is the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. And fortunately, he will be continued next week, I hope. Can you stand the line, sir?
Sure thing.